Today we are going to study one aspect of God that is not popular today. There are many pictures of God that Christians like. For example, God as a father. Some say this is the New Testament idea. But this is not true. In the Old Testament, we read about God as a father too. David called God Father. Isaiah speaks about the everlasting Father. And God himself talk about being the Father. God also reveals the qualities of mother. God compared himself with a mother eagle hovering over her nest. Jesus tells that he was like a mother hen that puts his chicks under the wing, his wings. Isaiah says that God is like a mother nursing her children. And God says, can a woman forget her nursing child and not have compassion on the son of the womb? They may forget, God says, but surely I will never forget you. There are over 100 names for God in the Old Testament alone. We need to study everything about God to make sure that we worship God of the Bible. We may not realize, but we might have an incomplete or false understanding of who God is. God is a father. He is like a mother. He is a judge, a prince of peace. He is all of that and more. But there is one quality that is emphasized in the Bible more than any other qualities. When we want to send a letter or email, how do we emphasize? We put a word or a phrase in italic, we underline it, we use capital letters. Well, the authors of the Bible, they used a different method. They would repeat things. John 1:3 says, but Jonah rose up to flee unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord and went down to Joppa, and he found ship going to Tarshish, and he paid the fare therefore and went down into it to go with them unto Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. Something is three times repeated in this verse. What is it? Tarshish. Three times it says Tarshish. Tarshish. Well, he was supposed to go to Nineveh, but he is going in the opposite direction. Two times something is repeated. From the presence of the Lord. From the presence of the Lord. So, you know, when they want to emphasize something, they repeat things. Well-known phrase, thus says the Lord, or you know, equivalents. And you read, especially prophets, thus says the Lord, and then prophet is saying, what is it? And then again, thus says the Lord, and sometimes in one chapter, a number of times, he says, thus says the Lord. Why are they doing this? They want to emphasize, they don't want us to forget that, you know, this is God who is speaking. So whenever they double or even triple a verb or a thought, that means this is what they want to emphasize. So what does this have to do with God's nature, his character? We mentioned that God has some fundamental attributes, and most people say that's love. Well, we cannot overemphasize love, but it's not love. Then maybe it is, you know, God is our Father. This is very important one. But again, it is not that it is not this one that the author emphasizes so much. Which one is it? God is holy. And the material that I'm going to share with you is taken from John Davidson. So Psalm 111 verse 9 says, "Holy and awesome is His name." God is described as the Holy One of Israel 24 times in Isaiah alone. He is called the Holy One in 2 Kings, Job, Psalm, Proverbs, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Habakkuk, and probably some other books. There are many attributes of God in Psalm 99. But let's read just three verses. Psalm 99 verse 3. "Let them praise your great and awesome name. He is holy." Verse 5. "Exalt the Lord our God and worship at His footstool. He is holy." Verse 9. "Exalt the Lord our God and worship at His holy mountain. For the Lord our God is holy." If you read this psalm, number of attributes are mentioned, but none is repeated. There is only one that is repeated, and it is repeated three times. God is holy. Isaiah chapter 6. Which attribute is emphasized in Isaiah chapter 6, verses 1 and 2? "In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord seated on the throne, high and exalted, and the train of His robe filled the temple. Above Him were seraphs, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were saying, 'God is love, love, love.'" Right? No. Verse 3. "And they were calling to one another, 'Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of His glory.'" Some say the Old Testament people, they were primitive, so they needed, you know, this emphasis on holiness. Well, we are advanced. We live, you know, in the New Testament mindset and many centuries after the New Testament. So we don't need to talk about holiness. Really? Revelation, our scripture reading, Revelation chapter 4. In Revelation chapter 4, we read about God and His throne and His attributes. So tell me, who wrote the book of Revelation? John. Which John? How do we call him? The beloved disciple. Why do we say that? John is talking about love more than any other Bible author. So this is the same John. John that is talking about love. And in Revelation 4, verse 8, he says, second part, "Day and night, the angels are saying," and they're saying what? God is love, love, love. Yes, God is love, but this is not what John is saying. God is good, good, good. This is a favorite philosopher's attribute. Well, God is good, but this is not what John is saying, that angels are saying. They never stop saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." holy, holy, holy. John exalts God's holiness. Holiness is the only attribute in the Old Testament and in the New Testament that is repeated 3 times. There is no other attribute that is repeated 3 times. And we know when something is repeated, especially if it is repeated 3 times, that is very, very important. The first thing that true worshippers of God say when they approach Him, and you know, this is the first thing that God is holy. And another thing is, what do they do when they approach God? They prostrate themselves to the ground. And when they approach the living God, they tremble. Jacob, he deceived his brother and father, and he fled to his mother's family, and on the way there he had a dream. He saw the ladders going to heaven, he saw angels going up and down, and when he woke up, what would you think that he said? Oh God, I'm so glad that you're telling me that you are with me, you know, that you're going to bless me and support me. No, he said that the text says that he was afraid. And he said, how awesome is this place. When Moses met God at the burning bush, the first attribute that God reveals about himself is holiness. Exodus 3:5. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. And it is holy because the holy God is there. Not because it's holy on its own. This was magnified when Moses brought the Israelites back to the same place. The whole mountain was filled with God's presence. And the Ten Commandments were given. And the Ten Commandments, it's a call to holiness. God told them, I want you to be holy because I am holy. When Moses requested to see God, what was his reaction? Exodus 34:8. Moses bowed to the ground and at once and worshipped. Later, when Nadab and Abihu told that God's instructions were not that important regarding the worship in the sanctuary, fire came down and killed them. And what did God tell? Leviticus 10:3. Among those who approach me, I will show myself holy. We are reminded over and over again of God's holiness. When Moses struck the rock because of that one outburst, he was not allowed to finish the journey to the promised land. And what did God say? Why didn't God allow Moses to enter the promised land? Numbers 20 verse 12. Because, and then says, you did not honor me as holy. What was Job's response when God has revealed to him? Chapter 22 verse 6. Job 42 verse 6. I despise myself and repent in dust and ashes. There is something about being in the presence of God. Joshua in chapter 5, you're not going to read, it says that, you know, he fell face down to the ground in reverence. So let's return now to Isaiah chapter 6. to the vision. What was Isaiah's response? Isaiah 6, verse 5. Woe to me, I cried. I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips, and my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty. Even Isaiah, the great prophet, was feeling his unworthiness and his sinfulness in the presence of God. There is something about being in the presence of the Holy God. Ezekiel and Daniel, they had the same experience. Ezekiel 1:28, when I saw it, I felt face down. Daniel 10:8, I had no strength left, my face turned deadly pale, and I was helpless. But that's the Old Testament. Does that change in the New Testament? We are told that that Jesus came to teach us about the love of God. So we don't need to have frightening experience in the presence of God. What about Luke chapter 5? Jesus performed a miracle of fish for these hard-working disciples. They worked all night and hadn't caught anything. And Jesus says, cast your net. And you can almost see the look on their face. Nobody fishes with net during the daytime. But because Jesus asked, they said, okay, we are going to do it. And you know the story. The net was so full, they could not get it into the boat. And their response was, Jesus, thank you. We don't need to work for a whole week. We can pay all our bills. That wasn't their response. Luke chapter 5, we read what Peter said. Luke chapter 5, verse 8. He, Peter, fell at Jesus' knees and said, go away from me, Lord. I am an sinful man. No matter whether it is the Old Testament or the New Testament, we see the same response in the presence of the Holy God. Ellen White comments on this story in Luke chapter 5. The presence of divinity revealed his own unholiness. Love for his master, shame for his own unbelief, gratitude for the condescension of Christ above all, the sense of his uncleanness in the presence of infinite purity overwhelmed him. Humanity, with its weakness and sin, was brought in contrast with the perfection of divinity, and he fell altogether deficient and unholy. Thus, it has been with all who have been granted a view of God's greatness and majesty. You remember the story when Jesus cleansed the temple and the reaction that people had? This is what Ellen White says. As he beholds the scene, indignation, authority, and power are expressed in his countenance. The attention of the people is attracted to him. They cannot withdraw their gaze. They feel that this man reads their inmost thoughts and discovers their hidden motives. The sound of traffic and bargaining has ceased. The silence becomes painful. A sense of awe overpowers the assembly. Looking upon Christ, they behold divinity flash through humanity. None presume to question his authority. a panic sweeps over the multitude, who feels the overshadowing of his divinity. What did happen? They saw a glimpse of his holiness. In Revelation, John describes his response to the vision of the heavenly throne. Revelation 1:17, first part, I fell at his feet as though dead. And John has encountered Jesus. The experience of divine holiness is overwhelming to sinful beings. It will cause us to tremble. What is the response of people at that time? They never say, Lord, you are so scary, I am afraid of you. That's not the response. They say, woe to me, for I am an unclean. Or, I repent in dust and ashes. Or, go away from me, for I am a sinful man. When people come to God's holiness, they realize how sinful they are. The Bible never gives us the impression that when human beings meet God, that he is scary or he is trying to frighten them to serve him. In his presence, in the presence of his holiness, we see who we really are. At that moment, there is no hand clapping and back slapping. Instead, we admit our guilt and we plead for forgiveness. We are not in the Garden of Eden anymore to welcome God's presence among us. After the fall, Adam and Eve run and hid from God. And you know, when God asked them, the answer was, oh, we hid because we were naked. At that point, were they naked? Not anymore. They had clothes that they made. But there was another problem that they didn't realize. It was God's holiness. They could not come because of sin. It is not that God is scary, but in the light of his holiness, we see who we really are. That we are sinners and we are frightened. It's much nicer to think of ourselves as good sinners. But unless we see God's holiness, we will never grasp the nature of sin and the radical nature of the atonement, why Christ had to die for us. And what the Holy God had to do to solve our problem. Some contemporary Christians want to remove or not to talk about this aspect of God, his holiness. But we should, you know, instead of ignoring it, we should focus on God's holiness. Because if we really want to understand God's love, we firstly have to understand his holiness. Because his holiness tells us about our sinfulness and tells us about the atonement, about the sacrifice, which tells us about his love. So you start with holiness, not with love. You start with holiness and you end up with love. Sin doesn't make us angry as it should be. When we sin, oh yeah, I shouldn't. There is little remorse. But in God's presence, we really see ourselves as we are. When we stand face to face with God, our self-justifying excuses are completely removed. There are no excuses. Only then, when we see ourselves, God can move us. And we want to skip this step. We don't want to meet holy God. We just want our sins to be forgiven and move on. But we really need to meet holy God in order to understand our sinfulness, in order to understand the atonement, in order to understand His sacrifice and His love. Whenever God is confronting us with His holiness and we realize our sinfulness, He's not leaving us there. Because that's despair, and He doesn't leave us there. He offers us forgiveness, but only after we see His holiness. So Isaiah sees the being around God's throne that cry out, "Holy, holy, holy." And then his response is, "Oh, God, but I am a sinner, a man with unclean lips." But what happens next? God does not leave Isaiah there. Isaiah 6, verses 6 and 7. "Then one of the seraphs flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth and said, 'See, this has touched your lips. Your guilt is taken away and your sin atoned for.'" Our holy God takes initiative to save us. But only when we understand His holiness, we can understand our sinfulness. And only when we understand our sinfulness, we can understand the atonement, the death, the Christ's death on the cross. The atonement wasn't a tea party. It was a drastic measure by holy God. Jesus took our sins upon Himself so that we can be with Him. The death of Christ was an execution, tearing apart God from God, because Jesus is God and He was separated from God the Father so that we could be saved. The deep understanding of Christ's death comes at the moment when we understand God's holiness. Yet, at that moment, people turn back. Some people turn back. We like the picture of God as our Father, or a Prince of Peace. And God is that. But true God of the Bible is the Holy God. Yes, He is a loving Father. Yes, He is the Judge. He is the Light, the Alpha and the Omega, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But He is also holy, holy, holy. After crossing the Red Sea, Miriam sang a song saying, Exodus 15:11, "Who is like you, majestic in holiness?" Amen. Amen. We are now going to separate for the foot washing. Ladies will go to this room and gentlemen will go at the back. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to his disciples saying, "Take and eat. this is my body. Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and offered it to them, saying, drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins.
Sent your Son to yield his body to be broken, that we may be restored. In your kingdom, we have eternal life. I just pray, Lord, that you would pray, that you would bless this communion, that you would bless this bread as a commemoration of your body being broken on the cross.
We are going to pray for the vine, and then we are going to kneel as we pray, and he will listen to you.
Dear Father in heaven, we thank you so much for your unconditional love We thank you so much for your son Jesus, who came and died on the cross because of our sin. We thank you that you given your only begotten son. His sacrifice makes us possible to live. We ask you to help us to surrender, to bring everything to the altar, to repent whatever little habits stay in our heart. Please help us to surrender, to give up, to turn away from sin in the name of Jesus. Please help that his blood not pure God because we will die, but because we will live, because we repent and we turn to him. Please help us to remember this sacrifice every day and to die to sin, to die to self. We ask you to clean our hearts, to give us a clean heart today, dear Father. In the name of Jesus.
Again, as we remember, as we drink this wine, remember what we need. Thank you.
Bible stands in closing hymn. Holy, holy, holy.
Just today, but every day, what Jesus done for us.